Yeah, there it goes.
Good.
I think we're in business. But yeah, what I loved about the Saito method and the reason I wanted to kind of interview about it was like there's no other conducting method that actually shows you technically what to do.
Yes.
They keep it, all the other methods keep it, it is very subjective, but they keep it so subjective. They'll show you beat patterns and they'll show you some staccato and legato, and then they tell you to use your left hand to show the phrase. But Saito is the only one that gives you like technical exercises. And as you know, I come from like a college like drumline marching background.
Yes.
So like I marched at Michigan State, and to do that, you have to love technical exercises. So that's why it appealed to me, and that's why I'm trying to master it really. How did so you eventually you originally just took a workshop, right?
I did. 1974, Courtney, BC.
And who was I with again?
It was supposed to have been with Saito, but he became very ill. He died in September of 74. So he was ill, and Professor Morihiro Okabe came in his place. But of course, the reason that the workshop existed was because of Maestro Kazuoshi Akiyama, who was conductor of the Vancouver Symphony. So he was the person who actually decided that this was a good idea. And then he invited several other people who had participated in lessons with Saito to be involved in this as well.
Is Saito taught all over Japan, or is it just one particular school?
I would say now it's probably two schools, Senzutsu Gakuin and Toho Gakuin, which was the school that Saito helped to found. There have been lots of conductors who have gone to different places, so they've used these different ideas. But even at Toho, where Saito worked for so many years, there were several different teachers who had their own ideas about what would work best for the students. And the key in dealing with Professor Okabe was, first of all, that he wanted to deal with real music rather than having people work on exercises for many, many weeks or months before they actually got the chance to work on real music. And of course, the other aspect was, as a pedagogue, he was interested in developing what was going on. And that's why I've often suggested that the Saito method isn't finished yet, that there will be ideas that come from certain pieces of music, or that we want people to be able to adapt the principles of the method to their own conditions.
Who would you say is leading it now?
It's very difficult to say, because for so long it was Mr. Akiyama and Mr. Ozawa. After Professor Okabe passed away, they replaced him with another teacher who was very dogmatic about the things that were in the textbook. And of course, that from Professor Okabe's point of view, didn't make any sense. You see, the original textbook was written largely by the students in his class and largely by Professor Okabe. So the idea of trying to refine things, to improve things, was very critical. So this replacement for Professor Okabe has now left, and I don't know who's actually taken his place at the school.
And you're the original person to translate the book or to edit the book into English, right?
Yes, I worked with my colleague Fumihiro Torigai, who actually taught in Saskatchewan, and he translated and I edited the material based on what I had learned. And then this also crossed the Pacific Ocean several times. I would send the material that we'd already prepared to Professor Okabe. He would approve it or make some suggestions for changes, and Mr. Akiyama also saw it. And so it took a long time. This was a 5-year project, every waking moment to prepare the text.
So I've noticed, I've talked to several professors about it because I'd go to these other conducting workshops, and almost every major professor I talk to says they've heard of it or they read a little bit about it like 20 years ago, but they really don't know much about it beyond that. So if you were to, if someone didn't know anything about it, how would you describe, like, what is the Saito method?
Well, the Saito method involves several really basic components. The first is the training of the arm. And what are the kinds of things that you need to do to show the beat more clearly? And that, of course, comes through the studies. The important aspect of this is that the method started out with the question, why is it easier to follow some conductors than others? So that still needs to be our question. And we also need to say, for this particular piece of music, what do the players need? And what's going to make this the best artistic product that we can possibly conceive of? So the first part then, of course, is the training. But the other part, I would suggest, is what we might say is ear cleaning. What do we have to do as a conductor? Who are we going to focus on in any particular place in time so that the piece will flow naturally together? And how do we get out of the way of the players from time to time and let their ideas and their musicality come to the fore, rather than feeling that this is something that's mechanical, something that has already been determined to begin with? Because most of us know that there are times in a concert where things change and we need to be able to change to either save it or to enhance it. So the Saito method then is a way of learning about the gesture, and it's a way of connecting with the music so that then people can apply it to whatever music, whatever styles they're going to be conducting.
It's interesting that you say that, because I took the Saito method as like a technical method. So yes. to me, it was sort of predetermined. You know what I mean? Like, when I studied the Saito method, I kind of got the idea that it was very technical. So there were, like, certain ways to do things.
Yes. But, of course, these are the studies. Mm-hmm. And as you read through the textbook, you'll see near the end of just about every chapter, it says, now try it a number of different ways. Mm-hmm. And so we look at the same way that you might suggest when you're starting to learn any instrument. There are certain ways that we would advise, for example, to hold a drumstick, and that there are certain ways that we would advise to think about that motion that somebody makes in using a stick to hit a drum. As a matter of fact, this is an example that Saito also uses, the idea of the drop of the drumstick to the drum. So after that, then, it's a matter of saying, okay, so now you have these skills. How will you bring your creative ideas to fruition by using these skills? And, of course, the real challenge is that for people who are not acquainted with it and who haven't spent much time really trying to get into it, they don't understand that it's anything more than choreography. We start out by helping people with specific suggestions about how to do it, and then the idea is, let's make some music with these ideas.
Yeah, it reminds me of a concept that I learned in drumline, and I believe I can't remember his name, but I think there's a famous jazz musician that does it this way, where he said, practice nothing but technique, and then play nothing but music.
Yes.
And when I was at Michigan State in the drumline, it worked out that way, because we would practice exercises hours a day, like hours, and then once we were done, you'd hear people just play beautiful things. They'd want to get out of their system. So all of a sudden, you know, we're done with exercise and people are just playing these beautiful solos. And I've been attempting to do that with Saito, where every day I spend about maybe 20 minutes practicing just the movements. And then when I actually go to conduct ensemble, I kind of try to forget Saito.
Yes.
And I let it come through me as it will, but I forget it. I don't try to do anything technical. I just conduct as it feels appropriate at the time.
Yes. And Saito makes reference to that in the textbook, where he talks about, you know, when we walk, we don't think about the specific motions of our feet and legs. Mm-hmm. We just walk. And so that's where we want to be able to get to. However, as you've already suggested, from a technical standpoint, if one has never learned to swing their arm. They've never learned to drop their arm. Then those are the foundational things about the gesture and how we're able to anticipate where beat points will occur. There are lots of different approaches to conducting, as you know, and I wouldn't want to suggest that they're wrong, but I would suggest that many of them are incomplete. And that becomes a problem. Are we frozen here?
I think we're not.
So the notion of making it complete, where, for example, we might look at a gesture that's a wipe, a wiping gesture. Mm-hmm. But how can that be of use to the music unless we understand the timing at the beginning of the wipe and at the end of the wipe? So there, we have to be able to think about these things. And typically we take people from where they're at. Unfortunately, with gesture, it's a matter that we haven't had some of these kinds of experiences. Not everyone has dropped a drumstick onto a drum. Not everyone has bowed a stringed instrument or felt what that's like. So we have to have those experiences incorporated too.
And that's another thing that I liked about it, was it is so similar to playing the drums, because Saito is the only method that talks about acceleration, deceleration.
Yes.
And in drumline, when you're playing eight on hand, most of the time is spent up.
Yes.
So it's, you know, up, boom, boom, boom. That's basically eight on a hand real slow. And Saito teaches the same thing, where there's a deceleration up, then an acceleration down.
Absolutely.
So that's definitely one of the things I enjoyed about it. So there's several basic movements. Like, I suppose if you had to break it down the most basic way, there'd be the gestures to a point and the gestures from a point, right?
Yes, although this is a way of categorizing the relationship of the gesture to the music. Mm-hmm. And that becomes a critical part of all of this too. When we're working with people who have printed music in hand, or they've played this material over and over again, they have certain expectations about what's going to be of some use. So for example, if there's a fortissimo passage and a conductor does this, if you're doing with a professional, they're going to play anyway.
Yeah.
But it doesn't inspire anybody to play fortissimo. And I think that becomes the aspect. When this thing works musically for you, there's a sense that you're so much on the same page, you're so much together with the ensemble, that it's absolutely mind-boggling that you can do some slight changes and it makes a huge change to what's happening in terms of the music. And that's what we want. We want to think about shaping. We want to think about how can we invigorate? How can we transfer some energy? And then in some cases, how do we just let the players take over and do what's going to make it happen musically?
So I thought we'd talk about something like the very basic gestures.
Yes.
And the first one would be the shakui, which is the scoop.
Yes, but I usually like to start with that.
Yeah, why do you usually start with that?
People are generally more successful with it. Mm-hmm. And particularly if we tie it in with that exercise where we wipe a music stand. So if we feel that we actually have some physical contact. And also it's something which is really focused, and we can think about a number of things at the same time, such as placement. And so we're also looking at customizing things for each of us as individuals. Where in your body do you have some strength that will show what you want, what the energy is? If I had to hold a weight for a long period of time, I would want it to be here, not here.
Yeah.
So if I'm conducting and I'm making a gesture up here, it doesn't have the strength that it would have coming down into this position. So the shakui itself also has that sense. Most people have moved their hand through water. They have some kind of an idea about what's going on there. And it's a very good way of being able to think about hand position. Mm-hmm. And how we as human beings are able to do things which are natural for us.
I think we're back.
Okay. So I was saying that we want it to be useful to us, natural for us, and useful for the players.
So if we had to demonstrate the sequi, to back up, the first thing you learn in Saito, like if you were to come to the workshop, is the drop, right? So you learn how to actually relax every muscle and just drop.
Yes. But, of course, as you have already experienced with a lot of people, that's really, really difficult for them.
Yeah.
That is so difficult because we're afraid of that, and we're not also aware of the muscles that are involved. So often I would start with the pillow in my lap and think about raising and then letting it fall rather than that big dropping motion. People who have played drums understand how that feels, what the rebound feels like. Lots of others don't.
I've been using that as sort of my pre-concert warm-up, where I actually go all the way up to here.
Yep.
And then you just let it swing. I usually get to maybe like 14 or 16 times.
Yes.
When you start counting. And then from there you get to the sequi. Like, it's like one thing I would note is that it's really hard to get these from either watching a quick video or even reading the book. Like, this is something you have to come to the workshop to really, like, I do believe this is something you have to learn in person and then work on yourself. But the very basic Saito pattern, the sequi, is a deceleration down, and then an acceleration down, then a deceleration back up. And it's, I believe it's a obtuse soft angle, right?
Well, we make it in curves, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And I was kind of calling it a soft angle because that makes the distinction between that and tataki, which would be more of an acute hard angle.
Absolutely. The critical aspect here too has a lot to do with how are we going to hold the baton and how does our arm work? And we know that as an exercise, we'll start out just doing this kind of gesture. I like to use this little laser light because it makes it a little easier to see.
Mm-hmm.
Got a little bit of light here. Yeah.
Yeah, I see it there.
We just think about that kind of shape, trying to create a kind of symmetry for what we're dealing with here. So the aspect then is how will we put our hand, generally starting downward, but if we need to connect to another sound, we might do this, where we turn this way so that we can strike more forcibly downwards. So that's a way of getting this thing going as a principle gesture that then we can add different layers to. We can challenge people to go on beyond that.
And everything you have to think before the point too, right? Like when you said you go over here to come up with like maybe a harder accent,
yes.
You're always thinking about preparing for what sound is coming next.
Yes.
Right, rather than what just happened.
Correct. And in many conducting methods, they use short little pushing jabs like this. And of course, it depends on the ensemble you're working with and what they expect. We do respond generally to these quick motions. But if we don't want a very hard articulation or we don't want a loud sound, this little jabbing motion, it comes so late that we can't anticipate it. We can't prepare as musicians to be able to perform together with that. I mean, you think about the difference compared to a string player, compared to a wind player, if you have to respond to a little jab like that. So the essence of this then is allowing that to fall. But most importantly here too, people come to understand that the after point motion, it takes up most of the time between the beats. And that the before point motion is actually very, very short, whether it's legato or staccato. So 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a, or 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a, we wait longer at this secondary point. And I see that as the most important contribution in all of Saito's analysis.
If you're going to break it into 16th notes, I felt like I would be up by E, then you stay up there till So it's sort of like 1E, a 2E, a 3E, kind of like that, right?
As long as the baton keeps moving. Yeah, it just has to keep following through. Boing, we have to feel that rebound. It has to continue to decelerate because that sustains the sound.
Is there beyond a in the 16th notes that you would switch from up to down? I guess it would be an ah, right?
Actually, I change of direction comes after the ah. If I go 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a, it's a very short period of time. It's less, in this case, than a quarter of a beat, even though it's very legato. So that becomes the realization. I have the power by waiting at the top. I can influence when that articulation comes and how hard it is by what I do timing-wise at the top of the gesture.
And one of the cool things about Saito was that you can influence what the subdivision is by the timing of the drop. So if you're doing a waltz, I know you'd come down. Like most other methods, they teach you if you're doing a waltz, it's just one big movement up and down. In Saito, they teach you explosion up, and then come down on three. So one, two, three, one, two, three, one. So you'd, on beat three, if I understand it correctly, on beat three, you'd actually drop at that point.
Yes. But also, if we think about this as a clock face, three actually comes, the secondary point comes lower than the apex of the gesture. So one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two. If I go one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three, it doesn't have the flow. So one, two, three, one. I allow that to come, and I also here, I'm using the arm motion where it falls backwards. So one, two, three goes forward, one, two. So I can do this for a much longer time than I could go one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three. That's what I'm saying. And this then creates a line in the music more than just the individual points, beat points.
One of the things I've been having trouble with in my own practice recently, I've been doing a lot of practice on the three 2-point gestures, shakui, which is the scoop, tataki, which is the sharp angle. But Heikenundo is challenging, actually.
Yes, it is.
And that's Heikenundo is basically there's very little or no acceleration or deceleration, and it's used for legato music. So it's just the same shape, except there's no acceleration or deceleration. And the challenge for me has been, are you subdividing eighth notes? Is it like one and two and three and four, where there's like a and one and two? Or is it just you don't even think about that and just try to go like this?
Well, remember, though, that in music, actually performance music, we're not likely to use Heikenundo over and over and over and over again. So we would incorporate that perhaps with a shakui or some other kind of gesture. Uh-huh. But to deal with this, it's still a 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a... You notice that what I've really changed here is the speed of the downward motion. So yes, that the secondary point is located farther from the beat point than it was before, compared to ba, da, da. So I go one, two, and if it helps to think about just the eighth notes, I would do that. One and two and three and.
Well, I noticed what you were doing differently. I may have understood it wrong because you were still coming down on the fourth note rather than on the and.
Yeah, that's the challenge, is that there's, you know, there's not much in the way of the timing where the before point motion can really, you don't have much time to show anything between a soft articulation and a hard articulation. And that's why dropping the arm, because that's as fast as you can possibly move it, generally, is so vitally important.
So if you don't use Heikkinundo a lot, like you said you wouldn't use it over and over again, you combine it with Shikui, when would you use Heikkinundo?
Typically, it's useful to show a sustaining quality on a gesture. Mm-hmm. So, for example, we have a very long, don't need to feel any kind of bump. We can talk about that way on the beat point. And there are times where, of course, you would add other aspects to this. For example, you can add a stretching motion where we just feel that we're doing this. So we add what looks like a little bit of elastic tension, or we can do it even more dramatically with a pulling motion. Mm-hmm. All of these things then add to different layers of this. But your specific question is, when do you use it? And in the situation such as study one, we can do this with a shakui gesture, and we can do it then also with Heikkinundo, just to make it a little smoother. Remember that this, we often need a greater impulse to start a piece of music than we can get with Heikkinundo. So it helps a lot if the performer like, and if they have some other way of really feeling this internal motion. And that's why we would do things such as add the kazutori, where if I went, I give this little bit of extra time for people to start to feel where that beat point is.
So over Christmas time, I was conducting Green Sleeves by Alfred Reed.
Yes.
Which I'm sure you've done many times. Yes. And I was using Heikkinundo for most of that. But when a new phrase would come in, I would switch to Shikui, and then you'd have a real strong entrance for the phrase.
Yes.
And I thought that worked well. So.
Absolutely. And of course, the joy of all of this is that once you have these skills, then you can experiment with them and see how they impact the ensemble, right? Mm-hmm. Because it really forces the ensemble to think differently when your gestures are that clear. What else is it that they're supposed to be able to do? And of course, the relationship between the conductor and the performers rests on their feeling the subdivision the same way you do.
And then the one other gesture we haven't talked a lot about or demonstrated was tataki.
Yes.
And that's been becoming my favorite. Okay. Just because it's kind of fun to do.
Yes.
Do you want to demonstrate that? Or?
Sure, I can do that.
And this is a sharp angle, basically. And use this for more staccato.
Right. In making this, it goes so rapidly that most of the time we feel more up than down. Mm-hmm. So if I go one, two, three. And I don't know if you're able to see the baton flash.
Yeah.
But you'll also notice that in this case, in order to maintain that acute angle, I'm turning my wrist slightly. Now I can do this all with my palm down. But as a human being, I prefer not to pull muscles that I don't need to.
Yeah.
And you talk to lots of conductors who have serious arm problems, lots of tendonitis. So when I'm doing this, I'm actually thinking about up. I'm thinking about up, up, up. So I contract the brachioradialis muscle for just an instant before I allow the arm to float up again. And that allows me to do this as much and as long as I need to be able to do it.
So you've avoided arm injuries then for a long career?
Arm injuries in conducting.
Yeah.
Big blocks of cement, not so lucky.
Yeah, that makes sense. One thing I've noticed when seeing other professors too is they might demonstrate a technique and then I'll be like, oh, okay, that's similar to Shikui. But they don't know it. To them, it's just the beat pattern.
That's right.
So Saito gives you like a context. Like you can watch something someone like Leonard Bernstein does or anybody and be like, oh, okay, that was like a Hanayage. So it gives you sort of like a context to understand what everybody else is basically doing intuitively.
Yes. And, you know, when we start to compare the conductors, I think that if you were to talk, my good friend played in the New York Philharmonic for many decades. And so he has stories to tell, courteous ones, about each of the conductors who he worked with. And of course, an energy, and it creates such a persona that he could have done just about anything mm-hmm. in order to make these people want to play music. We are dealing with geniuses. We're dealing with people who bring a very high level of understanding and lots of experience to it. Now, if we compare that to young people in a school group, it's quite a different situation. We have to do both the training and the educating of these young people so that we're able to do these things and make some magic. But you know that the greatest magic generally comes by delaying the next downbeat. And unless you're able to do this with a deceleration, people can't tell what's going on. They just think there's a mistake there. Mm-hmm. The important aspect about watching conductors, particularly on YouTube, is to turn off the sound. And if it's not obvious where the beat is or how you could anticipate it, or best, be able to try and clap eighth notes while they're conducting, or triplets, you know, and say, how could the ensemble possibly follow this person? Well, in many cases, they're not. They've already rehearsed this. They already have a sense of what's going on. And in some cases, the conductors are putting on a show for the audience.
I think that happens a lot. And I've heard from professional musicians that maybe more often than not, the professional musicians aren't even really watching the conductor, unless they're very
accessible. Absolutely. Well, not only that, but there's a notion of what does the ensemble or what does the player need from the conductor. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they just need a reassurance that this is the spot where they're supposed to start to play.
Yeah.
In other cases, well, for example, I listened to a recording on YouTube yesterday where an extraordinary ensemble playing with a world-class conductor didn't start the piece together. And it's a very, very common piece. They must have done it hundreds of times. They didn't start exactly together. And so my question is, what happened? And what would I have to focus on so that doesn't happen to me?
So one more question is, who's using the Saito method now? Like what kind of, who's using it?
We've had quite a few people who are involved in universities in Canada involved with it. Mm-hmm. So it changes from time to time, but we have quite a few professionals who are involved with or who have used these ideas. I've worked with quite a few of the people in the Canadian military who are using these ideas, and lots of school teachers. I found, frankly, that there are some people who are incredibly gifted, but they just haven't had the opportunity yet to work at a higher level. Mm-hmm. So that's a different kind of problem.
And these people, the school teachers that are using Saito, basically it's because they took your workshop, right?
Yeah, I've worked with a lot of people online, mm-hmm. and I've had a chance to teach several times in Memphis, Tennessee. And also in Boston. I taught in Brazil, in Salvador, Brazil, for the Nia Jabá program. And I met a lot of people using Skype. I've had people come from Australia and China to spend a week with me to work on some of their technical things. But as you know, we need to have time to develop. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we can do it in a day or two, but other times it really involves our own muscle memory. We have to give ourselves some time to make sense of this to ourselves, and then we can move on with it.
Yeah, because I was watching some of my videos from the workshop, And now that I've spent the last 6 months actually practicing the techniques, when I watch the videos, I'm like, wow, I was not accelerating. Because, you know, it was my first week ever doing it.
That's right.
So I learned some concepts at the workshop, and then but I needed to spend, you know, the next year at home actually rehearsing these. So people have discovered Saito Method and then sought you out and then asked for, like, Skype lessons before. Is that how that came to be?
Yes, but also there are quite a few people who studied with Saito in Japan, Japanese people who have gone around the world. There are a few teaching in Germany. Uh-huh. There are a few in the United States. And part of the challenge is that if they took a year of study with Saito, they may not have got the whole idea behind it. They may not have developed a sense of the pedagogy that's involved. And so what's really critically important is that we're facilitating what's going on with the students. We're trying to encourage people to look at what they're doing. And by doing what you're doing in looking at the video is ideal, because that's what my colleague George Charpentier and I have done always. Mm-hmm. We've looked at the video and said, you know, does this work? What are the kinds of things that I might have done differently? And of course, it's in the moment, as you know, with a concert, where you have lots of things to think about. You want to bring a sort of sense of comfort that we're here to make music with the ensemble. I'm not here to try to show off, or I'm not trying to show that I'm the only one who has a particular idea. I have suggested that conductors need to think of themselves as respectful collaborators. And I think that that is a huge change from what we saw 100 years ago, 50 years ago, mm-hmm. you know, where the idea of the maestro was the only one who knew what was supposed to happen in the music, and the rest were just supposed to follow along.
So if I understand it right, if people want to learn this, there is no grad school you can go to unless you speak Japanese. If you're an English-speaking person, pretty much if you want to learn this, your workshop is the place to go for it. There is no grad school for it, right?
Well, there are several people who are teaching in Canadian universities mm-hmm. Who have had experience with the Saito Method. And there's certainly one in Cumberland University, just outside of Nashville in Lebanon, Tennessee, where we've worked together many, many, many times. And I created a course material for his conducting course there. But the challenge is that there is a lot of power, if I can put it that way, yeah. resting in the hands of a few who have become famous. And it would be wonderful if they would understand. And the notion of conductors collaborating seems to be unusual. But that certainly benefited me for the many years that I worked with George Charpentier. We could be very forward and blunt about what we saw going on, and that's how we had a chance to grow. And when you ask conductors, who do you trust to give you feedback? Most of them don't have anybody.
Yeah, I think it becomes sort of a self-selection thing where the kind of person that wants to be a conductor is often the kind of person that wants to just be in charge of everything.
Yes.
So it can self-select that way, which is why it's turned out that way. Are there any Canadian universities that you think you've permeated the most?
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay.
It's changed. I mean, we had someone at the University of Ottawa and someone at the University of Calgary, but they've left.
Okay.
So that's changed.
So my recommendation is the workshop for everybody, and it happens every year in July. Do you remember the dates for the 2017 one?
Well, we're going from July 22nd to 29th, mm-hmm. and we've been fortunate to have the support of the Orchestral Association. That's how I'm able to offer a professional string orchestra as part of the workshop and still keep the fee low, I looked at the fees of a workshop that was held last week in California. Uh-huh. And the fees for the Saito workshop are much less than half. And the other one was a four-day workshop. This one is twice as long. So, yeah, I think the idea of it's too bad that we don't have some specific place where people could go to get some degrees. But I would suggest that the people who I've worked with who really want to learn about conducting aren't that concerned about the degrees.
Yeah, and so I've taken a number of workshops outside of Saito. And from my personal experience, Saito was the only one where it's like truly like the safe space for workshops where you don't feel like you're trying to impress anyone. You feel completely relaxed to make mistakes. You don't even have to dress up. You can wear what you want. You can wear a t-shirt. Yes. And you get to conduct multiple times per day if you choose. Yes. So most other workshops, you get 10 minutes once a day. You're on the spot. Everyone's judging. And oftentimes, the people facilitating the workshop will kind of feel like they need to put on a show.
Yeah.
But at the Saito workshop, there's no show. There's no ego. You can make mistakes. You can wear a t-shirt and you can feel comfortable. So it's very different. And you get multiple chances per day. You can easily get 3-4 chances a day to conduct at your workshop. I'm
delighted that you give that feedback because that's what we want. I think that we're trying to create a community of professional artists and conductors. And we've had such a combination of people with different levels of degrees from different places in the world. And also, the idea is that if we can create that kind of safe place, I believe we learn better. Mm-hmm. Most of us have been through those other experiences from hell. And whatever people were able to take from them, I'm not sure. One of my friends and colleagues here said, everybody will tell you who they studied with, but they won't tell you what they learned. So that was a motivator for me to say, okay, so what did you learn and who can you share with? Now if we have this group of colleagues from the workshop who you could share video with, or, you know, support is an important part of all of this, right? Because typically, you've already said it, people are quick to condemn, and they'll say, well, this is nonsense, or this won't work. What we want to do is to say, how do we improve, and how do we grow?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just in general, too, there's probably hundreds of people interested in studying conducting, maybe thousands in North America. And what I love about it is there's a very specific technical method that's only taught in one place, and it's in Saskatoon.
Yes.
So, to me, if you want to, even if you're not interested that much in Saito, but you just want to master conducting in general, there's like this whole sort of department here in Saskatoon you can go to and learn a whole new method, and at the very least take some tricks back home with you. So, I definitely recommend the workshop to anybody, and I'll be there this year, so.
I appreciate that, and we'll look forward to working with you again. I guess I'm excited that some people have returned, as many as 6 times.
Yeah, I've seen, when you look back at the photos over the years, you see some repeating faces over and over and over again.
And the interesting thing about these people is that they already have a degree or standing in conducting from other places, mm-hmm. from most of the so-called famous places. So I love the idea that they're interested in sharing and learning, and they do bring their own genius to what's going on that I think enriches everything that we do. So I'd look forward to communicating with anybody who's interested. I had hoped that in the past 15 years I would have been able to do even more in sharing these really important ideas. But as long as I have the energy and the support, I'm happy to do what I can.
So the place to start would be your website, I believe. Is it conductorschool.com? Or?
That's correct. Yeah. Okay. And there are some resources there, but also ways to connect with me. And I'm happy to share ideas. And certainly if anybody's keen in developing some of these or starting to learn about them, I see that as an opportunity to make a difference in the communities in which these people conduct. Because typically people have gone from the workshop and said, my group said, how come you're so much more clear? What are you doing differently?
Yeah.
How come we can make the music, how come it's easier to play now than it used to be? That's the common thing. And I'm fortunate that no one has ever told me that they felt they'd wasted their time and money. So that's even better.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, well, I think that's probably good. This gives people a little background on it, and I guess I'll see you this summer, if not
good. Sooner. Thank you. Thank you for doing this, and we look forward to communicating with people who are interested in learning more about the method.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.